Good morning. The meditation this morning is, faithful God, thank you for loving me first, even when my heart was too wounded and hurting to trust you. Thank you for the many ways you reach me wherever I am, and that comes from our daily bread. Please join me in the call to worship. For God alone my soul awaits in silence, for my hope is from him.
He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be shaken.
On God rests my deliverance and my honor. My mighty rock, my refuge is in God.
Trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us.
Those of low estate are but a breath. Those of high estate are a delusion. In the balances they go up, they are together lighter than a breath.
But no confidence in extortion, and set no vain hopes on robbery. If riches increase, do not set your heart on them.
Once God has spoken, twice I have heard this, that the power of God and steadfast love belongs to you, O Lord. For you repay to all according to their work. Our opening hymn this morning is Jesus Calls Us or the Tumult. It can be found in the black hymnal, and it's number 172. Please stand to sing if you are able.
Day, that voice still calls us, saying, "Great." kindred, leaving all for Jesus' sake. Jesus calls us from the worship of the treasures we adore, from each idol that would keep us, saying, Christian, love me more. In our joys and in our sorrows, days of toil and hours of ease, Jesus calls in cares and pleasures, Christian, love me more than these. Jesus calls us by your mercies, Savior, may we hear your call. Give our hearts to your obedience, serve and love you best of all.
Continuing with the invocation and Lord's Prayer. God of many seasons, we enter into your presence with joy and thanksgiving. We acknowledge all the ways that you meet us as we gather in your name. May our songs and prayers be a sweet sound in your ears. May we demonstrate our trust in you through both praise and lament. May our hearts yearn, our spirits stir, and our souls wait in the holy hope and expectation. We pray as Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the
be seated. Good morning once again on this blustery January morning. I hope everyone's staying warm. We continue to need people to sign up for flowers in the narthex. We didn't have any today. That's why we have those lovely fake ones.
But still lovely.
Yes, still lovely. But next week and most of February are open. So if anybody's willing to bring some in. We also need people to sign up for coffee hour down in Fellowship Hall. That's on the wall. The Bible study continues in the study of Isaiah on Tuesday. That's at 6 p.m. and Greg is asking for you to read Isaiah 1-5 if you're able, and all are welcome to attend that. The annual meeting will be next week following church, and after the meeting we'll be having soup and sweets, and we're looking for people to donate sweets if they're able. Also, copies of the minutes from last year's meeting and the report from this year are here if you'd like to grab one before. Yes, Carolyn, I see your hand.
And just on the soup and sweets, if anyone would like to help serve on soup and sweets, you know, afterwards, come down and help serve the congregation, that would be very welcome. Just let me know, or be here with bells on, that would be greatly appreciated.
Okay. We continue to collect non-perishable food items for the food pantry, and that box is in the narthex. Reverend Greg's blog can be found on his website, which is listed there. And also, he's available on Fridays in his office if anybody'd like to see him, and you can contact him with your request. Are there any other announcements this morning?
Good morning again, everybody. Hope you're all doing well today. I did hear a good rumor that it's going to be warmer this coming week. So that's good because the slush in my driveway turned to solid rocks of ice last weekend. So I'd like to sort of resolve that issue. And so if you found yourself in a similar situation or you want to extend this metaphor beyond what it probably should, there are times in our lives when things get very hard and blistering and unpleasant, but there are sunnier and warmer times ahead. If there are no further announcements, I'd like to move on to our time of joy and concern. We have our continued prayers this week for Leon Cudworth Sr. and for Leon Cudworth Jr., for Anne Marie Allen, for Dick Field, for Eunice, for Mary, for Millie Moore, for Pat Gonsalves, for Nick Riccardi, for Bethany Costa, for Bobby Files, for Tony Ribello, for Franklin McMullen, for David Rzuski, and for Audrey DeMora. My friend Curtis Diaz, who's the pastor at the Calvary Pentecostal Church in East Freetown, suffered a heart attack, I believe, last week. He is in good condition, but he's not out of the woods yet. He still needs our prayers. This has also necessitated a rescheduling of some aspects of the Lenten series, and we'll have more information on that by next Sunday. We always pray for Tiff Vonica. We also pray for Kim, who trying to put her keeper family together. She received some shocking news. Her brother's girlfriend, who was for all intents and purposes his wife, passed away this past week, and that was a very hard for him and for her and the family. So please keep the Vonicas in your prayer, the larger extended family. Are there any other prayer requests this morning? Then let us all pray together. Heavenly Creator and Friend, let us listen to your call. Let us praise you with all our power for your steadfast love and glory. Let us see you reflected in the world and people around us, and let us hear your word through the scriptures and through our prayers. As we pray, we cannot help but realize how far we have wandered from your call into acts that ignore you, so we may continue to do what makes us feel comfortable. We let others suffer, or in our selfishness, we minimize the dignity of their humanity. Forgive us for these and all our sins, and bring us back to listen to your call. We thank you for this gift of grace and for all the other blessings of our lives. Therefore, we are bold to ask for your compassion in this brokenness around us. We pray that we might find a sanctuary from the noise of the political season, and that our leaders of all kinds might put their call to service above their need for power. We pray that those who feel powerless due to how much money they have or how they are treated because of their race, body type, or expressions of self. We pray for those who help others as much as they can and who serve their country and their community. We pray for those burned out by care and grief. We pray for those whose lives have been shattered by loss. We pray for all those in hospitals undergoing difficult surgeries and treatments and who are struggling to battle cancer and other grave concerns. We pray for those going through physical therapy and the long road to recovery. We pray especially for Leon, for Anne Marie, for Dick, for Tiff and for Kim, for Eunice and for Mary, for Millie, for Pat, for Nick, for Bethany, for Bobby, for Tony, for Franklin, for David, for Audrey, and for Curtis. We need your peace, O God. We need your guidance. We need to listen to your call. So we open our hearts that we may say our silent prayers and listen once again to your word. Heavenly Creator and Friend, let us listen to your call. Amen. Did everyone get a small package of Swedish fish? Right, if anybody did not, let me know. You do not have to eat this package of Swedish fish because you may not be unable to eat sugar, or you may just not like the taste. But I wanted to give this to you today to remind you of an old adage, and that is, if you give a man a fish, he will eat for a day. Now, who knows the other half of that equation? Yes. That's right. If you teach a man to fish, he'll eat for a lifetime. So I'm not here today to teach you how to fish. In fact, I'm not very good at fishing, and I don't particularly like it for a number of reasons. But I do like the taste of fish, and I do like the taste of Swedish fish probably more than I should. But I'm not here to teach you to fish. But I'm also here to remind you of our Bible story today, which the one from the Gospels, which talks about when Jesus first saw Andrew and Peter and James and John on the lakeside and said to them, I will teach you to fish for people. Now, I think that part of my job is to teach you how to fish for people. And that's actually why we have these Sour Patch Kids, which are in the shape of people, kind of. And I think it's interesting because as you go out from church today, I'm gonna ask you to please take one of these back with you. Again, you can eat these or not. Again, you might, for the same reasons, you might not like these, might be too tart for you. They're not as tart as they used to be, I remember back in the day. They're not as tart as they used to be, but they still might be for your taste. But I think that tartness is important. Because when we go out into the world and when we try to help people learn how to love Jesus, when we teach them what it means to live a life of Jesus, not just to receive a gift of grace, but to live a life where grace becomes every moment, it's not easy. It can be a sour experience. Not everyone wants to listen. Not everyone wants to be transformed. So as you walk out of church today and you take this package of Sour Patch Kids and your package of Swedish fish, remember that you've been given a gift that will help you eat for a day, but you have the opportunity to teach people how best to live for a lifetime. Let us pray. Please pray with me. Dear Lord, we thank you for feeding us with your body and with your grace. Help us to feed the bodies and souls of our neighbors in time sweet and sour. Amen. Our communities and our world rely upon the generosity of those who have received the Creator's abundance. So let us now offer our gifts in the knowledge that some wait on us to act, to share, and to give. This morning's offering will now be received.
Lord,
Rise.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Praise God above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Let us pray. Eternal God, magnify these gifts that we return in gratitude and for your glory. Amen. Our hymn of preparation today is from the Black New Century Hymnal. It is number 173. Now, if you look on page 173 in your hymnal, you can see that the hymn is a little on the complicated side. And so if you do not read music or Spanish, I have printed out, or I had Kathy print out, the English lyrics here as an insert. This may be easier for you to look at this than at the bulletin, than at the hymnal. Either way, I'm going to ask Cheryl to please play the tune through once so we can sort of hear it, and then we're all going to sing together. Again, this is You Have Come Down to the Lakeshore.
A love that's willing to go.
You may be seated. The Old Testament lesson this morning is from Jonah, chapter 3, verses 1 through 5, and verse 10. It can be found on page 678 and 679 in your pew Bibles. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up and go to Nineveh, the great city, and proclaim it to the message that I tell you." So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days' walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk, and he cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh will be overthrown." And the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on sackcloth. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. The gospel lesson is from the book of Mark. It's chapter 1, verses 14 through 20, and it can be found on page 731 in your pew Bible. Now after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little farther, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boat mending the nets. Immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. And so endeth the reading.
Good morning again, everyone. I usually pick out the hymns for Sunday mornings at least a month ahead of time. I want to make sure that they get in the bulletin and that Cheryl has some time to practice them. But I usually finish my sermons a few days and sometimes hours before the service. So as I was looking back on the hymns that I picked for today, I noticed that they are all about Jesus calling people from the shore to become fishers for people. You know, this is the lesson from the Gospel after Mark, after all. But I noticed something else that I don't think I picked up when I chose them, because I was paying attention to the lyrics. And that is how gentle and sort of lilting they are in the music. Whether the melodies are from the 1800s in England or the 1900s in Spain or traditional music from Ireland. When Jesus calls to the fishermen on the Sea of Galilee, he is likewise gentle. There's something that's more than just his words. It's how he says it. And we can sort of feel this just by reading between the lines of the Bible, because he's not loud or brash. He doesn't make a splashy entrance, either literally or figuratively. Jesus' call, at least as it is interpreted by the hymns, is soft but insistent. It invites us to leave behind the tumults of life's wild, restless seas, to abandon our small boats, to seek other seas. These lessons of calm and peace are necessary when the storms of life are swirling around us. When we come here to this sanctuary, we take the time to quiet our hearts and to listen to the call that Jesus is making to us. When we set time out of our busy or troubled lives to be here, we are implicitly acknowledging a very important fact. Because Jesus does not call to us only on Sundays between 10 and 11. Jesus is always calling to us. Jesus is always speaking to us, to new things in calming ways, which is remarkable, since new and calm are not words that are often put together. But if we only react to Jesus' call for 1 hour a week as if that's the only time it was present in our lives, what does that say about the rest of our time? And what does it say about people who either never hear the call of Jesus or just choose to ignore him? I think some of the answers are found in our Bible readings today. That shouldn't be a surprise to you. So let's look at that story from Mark in a bit more detail. In Mark's version of this story, which appears in a number of Gospels, Jesus does not begin his ministry until after his forerunner, John the Baptizer, is arrested. Jesus comes to Galilee, presumably after spending some time with Judea and the south, and begins proclaiming the good news, saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." And as Jesus passes by the sea, not rushing or marching or striding, but passes by the sea, he notes two pairs of brothers who are fishermen. He says to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of people." And at first, Simon and Andrew and then James and John leave their boats to follow him. Hearing this story, we too want to run out and follow Jesus as well. For even in this quiet pleading 2,000 years ago, there's something exciting in Jesus that we want to be a part of and that we want to share with other people. Jesus calls out to many people over the course of his ministry, but not everyone heeds him. This leads to another question. Why do some people answer the call to love and to serve through their faith? And why does that message so often fall upon deaf ears? What was it about these fishermen that made them listen to Jesus when so many others did not? And to help us answer these questions, let's now look at our other lesson today from the book of Jonah. Now, we all know the story of Jonah. When I say Jonah, you think of and the whale. Okay. So Jonah gets swallowed by a whale and then is released onto the shore 3 days later. And the New Testament reminds us that this is important because it anticipates Jesus being swallowed by death and then returning to life 3 days later. But there is more to the story of Jonah than just the whale part. The book of Jonah, which is 4 chapters long, begins with these verses. "Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai, saying, 'Go at once to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me.' But Jonah set out to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord." So the reason that Jonah ends up in that whale's stomach to begin with is because he runs away from God. He rushes out to the ocean, and once he's out there far, the storms of destruction are coming. He realizes it's his fault, and he jumps into the sea to save the sailors, not entirely voluntarily. He runs away, though, from what God wants him to do. Why did Jonah run away? What was it about this particular message that made him flee if he was a prophet of God? And I think it's because he did not want to go to Nineveh. And it's because he did not want God to forgive the Assyrians, the enemies of Israel, Nineveh being their largest and capital city. All right. So if I say Assyrians, you say nothing, because the Assyrians might be a little confusing to you. So why are the Assyrians so... Why does Jonah hate the Assyrians so much? Now, what's that? The Philistines live, they're down in the southwest of modern Israel, kind of in the area of Gaza today. It's actually why Palestine is called Philistine. It's because the Romans wanted to change the name to something that the Jews that they were kicking out didn't like. So now you know. But the Assyrians actually lived in what's modern-day Iraq. During the time of ancient Israel, there were two big world powers. There were the Egyptians, who were based around the Nile River. Rivers were really important. And then the Mesopotamians, who lived in modern Iraq around the rivers of Tigris and the Euphrates. Now, because of the way that roads work, you didn't cross across the desert. You kind of went around in a crescent. And so right on the road between Mesopotamia to Egypt was Israel, right in the middle. And they got caught in the middle of the conflict between these two great powers. And usually, they had to pay tribute to the Mesopotamians rather than the Egyptians. Now, in Mesopotamia, there were different empires or civilizations or cultures or dynasties that held the most control over the period of time. And essentially, there were two of them. There were the Babylonians, who were based around the city of Babylon in the south, and there were the Assyrians, based around the cities of Asshur or Nineveh in the north. Now, these two empires would go back and forth, conquering each other over the years. But the biggest difference between them, at least as far as the Israelites were concerned, was how they treated the people that rebelled against them, because they were just far enough away from Israel that Israel would try to exert its independence every once in a while. And in this respect, the Assyrians were especially harsh. They favored completely wiping out their enemies. And they had a policy that mixed exile with intermarriage to make sure that anybody they didn't like would disappear. It was an early form of genocide. And so have you ever heard of the lost tribes of Israel? Do you ever wonder how they got lost? The answer is the Assyrians. They came into the northern part and made sure that all the tribes of Naphtali and Ephraim were gone to history. The Assyrians were ruthless, they were cruel, they were especially arrogant about their military might. They were the boogeymen that were used to frighten Israelites young and old. And now Jonah says, God wants me to help them, to give them an opportunity to weasel out of the divine wrath that they so justly deserve. And Jonah did everything in his power to not be a part of this, and then sulked when God made him do it anyway. But when we get to the fourth chapter of Jonah, God, just as God has the first word, God has the last word. So at this point in the story, Jonah has preached to the Assyrians, just as we heard in our lesson, and then he goes and sulks to see what's going to happen. He really hopes that they're not going to listen, but they do. And as he's sitting out in the desert, God makes a bush to grow over Jonah to give him some shade. The next day, however, God lets the bush die, and Jonah is furious that God would let this happen. But God says this in reply. You are concerned about the bush, for which you did not labor, and which you did not grow. It came into being in a night, and it perished in a night. And should I not be concerned about Nineveh, that great city, in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know the right hand from their left, and also many animals. That's the last verse in the book. God reminds Jonah that Nineveh has a huge population and that God cares as much for Israel's enemies as for Israel itself. For all people, Jonah teaches us, are God's children. But there's something more going on here as well. How many times does God have to warn Nineveh through the prophets before they seriously repent and turn their ways around? How many times? Once. How many times does God have to warn Israel through the prophets before they seriously repent? Again and again and again, and you might argue it never happens. Jonah is unique among the prophetic books in that it does not contain the sayings of the prophet, but rather it's a story about a prophet. And to be honest, it's a rather fantastical one. Jonah goes out to Tarshish. If you try to put Tarshish on a map, you can't do it, because the word Tarshish, the place Tarshish in ancient Israel, was this faraway land. It's the ends of the earth. It's Timbuktu. It's this long, faraway place that's beyond their understanding. It's almost a fictional place in the way they use the idiom. It's a place where there's a journey to Tarshish. It's a book where someone gets swallowed by a whale, where bushes instantly are brought to life and then die. And it's one that depicts Nineveh, which was a large city for the time, as being so vast that it takes 3 whole days to walk from one side to the other. This story may seem more at home in something like 1001 Nights or Grimm's Fairy Tales than in the Bible. It's a lot of folklore in this story. There's a kernel of truth, but there's a lot of folklore going on as well. Now, based on the words and structures of the language, many scholars believe that this was actually written after most of the prophetic books, and certainly not in the time of the prophet Jonah, who is mentioned in the second book of Kings before the stories of Isaiah and all the other prophets. And so some scholars actually go as far to say that this book, the book of Jonah, is a parody of being a prophet. It's about somebody who runs away from God rather than answering the call. And more pointedly, I think, more importantly, it indicates how bad the Israelites were at listening to God's message compared to their worst enemies. And when someone was retelling the story of Jonah, one of them reminded them that Israel is not good at listening and reading the books of the prophets. And after all the resistance that we have to prophets like Jeremiah and Ezekiel, to hear of now Nineveh listening to Jonah, one might imagine God looking over all the books of the prophets and saying, well, at least someone listened. Who listens to God? The book of Jonah teaches us that a brutal empire might be more open to God's word than God's chosen people. The Gospels teach us that only simple fishermen, but not only them, but tax collectors, and sinners, the other people engaging in what we would call sinful professions, they all answered the call. Those learned Pharisees, those powerful Sadducees, they did not. And as the ministry of Paul indicates, Gentiles were more likely to become the followers of the way of Jesus than Jews were at the time. Now, I say this not to cast aspersions upon the Jewish people. Plenty of Christians have done that over the years. But rather to say that the Bible demonstrates that it's often the people that are the most holy and consider themselves the most faithful that actually listen to God the least. Again, who listens to God? Is it us? Is it the people who call themselves Christians on a census but never darken the doors of a church? Do they listen to God? Is it smiling people in the pews who then go home without being changed by the call of Jesus? We would probably say these people are not listening to God. So what gets in their way? I think the answer is sin. Because as I've said before, sin is whatever hurts other people or gets in the way of your relationship with God. So when we are tempted by sin, the voice of God is drowned out by the noise of life. Sin teaches us to stay in our comfortable place and to live a life that is not challenged by God's difficult call to justice and to self-sacrifice. And for those whose lives are full of suffering and disappointment, sin calls them to escape into destructive lifestyle choices and relationships. Perhaps what made those fishermen on the Sea of Galilee so special was that they were in the right place at the right time in their lives to listen to Jesus. They were struggling enough to not put their success and their comfort before God, but they were not so jaded by the troubles of life to seek out empty pleasures as an alternative. Our goal as Christians is to find this happy spot in our lives. We need to be open to the shock of God's anger, as the Assyrians were. We must be open to leaving behind what comforts we have, like those fishermen did, to follow Christ even to the point of a cross. And if we can do this, if we can take the time to pray and let the voice of God cut through that cacophonous noise of life, we can finally hear God's words. We can be transformed by them and transform the world around us through them. Jesus is always calling us. Let us listen and let us pray. Lord Jesus, open my ears to hear your word and respond as your disciple. This we pray in your most holy name. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning comes once again from the Black New Century hymnal, and it is number 504, You Walk Along Our Shoreline. Hope I said that correctly. Again, number 504. Please rise if you are able, and let's all sing together. So now let the grace of God, the hope of God, and the communion of God rest and abide in you and shine through you as you arise into the world, listening to and speaking Jesus' word. Amen. Let us turn to our neighbors and sing.
Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love, the fellowship of kindred minds is like to that above.